right, let's start by talking about ADH. And I kind of put this together as a simple diagram of what we had talked about last time. I say ADH, or vasopressin, is a direct action hormone. Describe what's meant by direct action. It's secreted into the bloodstream, and when it reaches its target, it does the physiology. In this example, it increases water reabsorption. Which what we had said last time effectively increases blood volume, increase BP, the good old blood pressure. Now, I drew a cell going from the hypothalamus to the posterior pituitary, right? Because it's a direct neural connection synthesized here, released here from the posterior pituitary. It acts on the kidney tubules to do that, or like I say here, water reabsorption, increase BP. Let's talk about, basically how it stimulated and what inhibits it. For example, start over here. Drink a bottle of water, adequately hydrated, that turns off the ADH. So I'll say adequate hydration inhibits. So think about this, if you're inhibiting that hormone's release, what is it going to do to the urine output and urine concentration? Up or down for the urine output? You're inhibiting that hormone. Up. You're going to urinate more, and the concentration will be more watery. Okay. Increase urine output, decrease urine concentration. And we've all experienced that, right? Drink a bottle of water and it makes you go more because, well, basically, we always say, it goes right through me. Well, it's kind of a misconception. I think what you're doing is you are basically decreasing the saltiness of your blood. Your brain can pick up on that and secrete less of this. So you just let more out of the kidney, which is already filtering all your blood volume anyways, producing that fluid. On average, your kidney will produce something like a mil a minute. You just kind of modulate that to affect urine output, okay? So if you're dehydrated or thirsty, that kicks it on, okay? So go over here, dehydration. You're gonna increase ADH circulating. Bloodstream. And it's just basically, well, I already told you what it does that, but it's going to reverse this. Decrease urine output, it's more concentrated. When we talk about urine concentration more when we actually get to the kidney, but I want to move on and talk about all the other ones, or most of the other ones that we did. For example, this one's oxytocin. I had mentioned it, but I didn't tell you the function of oxytocin. Mostly in females. In females, it targets smooth muscles in different things. Right. Also direct action, also secreted from the posterior pituitary. And when it circulates in females, it's going to target the smooth muscle in the mammary ducts. So for the suckling infant, which triggers its release. It'll help let the milk down. It's simply called milk letdown. So targets. Smooth muscle. And mammary ducts. You know, of the breasts. That's why we're mammals. We feed our young with milk from the mammary glands. But I'm not talking about the glands that produce milk in the breast. I'm talking about the ducts. Okay, the milk is already there, and you just have to let it down. So the suckling implant will help release oxytocin. It makes the smooth muscle contract in a way that opens the duct. Okay. Or milk let down. Not milk production, it's a different hormone, it's just letting the milk out. All right, also, it can help the cervix dilate. The cervix is the bottom part of the uterus where the baby is. So think about labor and delivery when about to give birth. That needs to dilate like 10 centimeters to accommodate baby's head to get through. And so that dilation will stimulate the release of oxytocin, along with the uterine stretching, because baby is like, you know, stretching the wall. And those things help induce labor. The obstetrician can help too. They can rupture the membranes, and it's very painful. And we'll talk more about that when we get to repress. But it causes the smooth muscle in the uterine wall to contract to help push baby out. Okay, so. Targets smooth muscle in uterine wall during labor and delivery. Also, sex arousal has been known to cause the secretion of oxytocin. If I put sex arousal in there, you know, in some animals, mating triggers ovulation, but that's not the case in humans. But the sex act in humans does trigger the release of oxytocin. And so oxytocin can help contract the uterus, and that kind of helps like wash the semen up to where the egg might be. So it does increase the chance of conception during sex, even though it doesn't trigger ovulation as it may do in other mammals. All right, so that's what it does. I don't teach anything it might do in males, I don't even know. But I want you to know what it does in females. Milk let down and contractions during labor. Now, those are the two posterior pituitary hormones. For the anterior pituitary hormones, we went through that whole song and dance. I tabled it all out where I gave you each tropic hormone from the hypothalamus and then how it released each hormone from the anterior pituitary. Okay, and what it targeted, and then now I kind of want to talk about what the anterior pituitary hormones ultimately do, starting with this axis. These endocrine axes, I just put axis on the board. Basically, you start from the top and you go down the way I have it illustrated. And so memorize the progression. Okay, this will be on your test. TRH, TSH, the thyroid gland is affected, the thyroid hormone. So let me put a check mark next to all the hormones. With three check marks. The first two are tropic, right? This was on today's test. I think these are two of the choices. That one's tropic, that one's not. This one does the physiology. Thyroid hormone is basically, in a nutshell, it increases metabolism in the human body. I'll fully teach the thyroid and what it does in the third lecture, probably on Thursday. So for now, just note, thyroid hormone affects has a thermic effect, increases metabolism, different way of saying it. Also know the feedbacks. When you increase circulating levels of the thyroid hormone, it turns it off at the hypothalamus level, so you don't boost metabolism too much. So usually how it's illustrated is, I don't know, you just kind of like feed back. If you forgot what that means, basically you're turning off the original stimulus. So elevated levels of thyroid hormone, you got enough, turn it off. Okay, I want to talk about growth hormone. I have a lot on this slide. Okay, what we talked about last time is GHRH can stimulate its release. GHIH would inhibit its release from the somatotropes. But what does growth hormone do? Let's kind of map that out. If you look at the bottom of the slide, pay attention to these curves. Anabolic effects of growth hormone and the anti-insulin effects of growth hormone. Talk about the anabolic effects first. It will target the liver. The liver will secrete these growth factors that act like insulin. Insulin-like growth factors. Targets liver to secrete insulin-like growth factors. IGF for short. Now, insulin is your major tissue-building anabolic hormone. Anabolic in physiology means build. Increase your stores to survive the winter, you know, something like that. And so, but this is not insulin. These are growth factors that are like insulin. They have an anabolic effect. And so what they do, growth hormone does, you increase your lean mass, you increase muscle mass, and you increase your bone and cartilage growth. So IGFs have an anabolic effect. Effects. Where the effects increase muscle mass, increase bone and cartilage growth. Basically, we say you have lean mass and fat. Lean mass includes mostly muscle, but also bone and blood. So this is most of that. On average, people are about 80-20, 80 lean, 20 fat on average. So growth hormone does that, the anabolic effects. The anti-insulin effects, it's like you need fuel to do this. It's a lot of cell work to increase your lean mass, okay, if you've been working out. So you need fuel to do it. So the anti-insulin effects are breaking down your stores of energy so you can accomplish this work. So the anti-insulin effects are interesting for this hormone. Not only does it do what insulin does, it also does the opposite of what insulin does. It breaks stuff down so you can kind of have energy to do work. So the anti-insulin effects are I have increase free fatty acids and increase the glucose in the blood. And the human body basically has two things it can burn for fuel: fat and sugar. That's it. Okay? When you read your nutrition label, just the two things you could possibly use for fuel is carb and fat. Okay? And there's nothing else. So growth hormone is breaking down both, increase it in the bloodstream so tissues can use it to build. Okay. Increase, that FFA stands for free fatty acids. Fat, basically. What's a free fatty acid? Well, what's fat? Fat is triglycerides. It's how we store it all over our body. So if I draw like a letter E, that's like the simplest way I could draw a triglyceride, a storage form of fat. You eat fat, you burn it, you store it, okay? And I think we all know where the fat is on our bodies, don't we? But that's how we store it. The backbone is a glycerol molecule. And each hydrocarbon chain is a fatty acid. So when you're, I don't know, a trainer or a coach saying, work out, burn fat, that's the fat. Lipase can break that apart. The fatty acid can be liberated from this triglyceride molecule and, single fatty acid. And that can circulate in the blood. So if I say circulate, it's understood in the blood. What else is going to circulate in? And basically, that is the molecule that can enter the muscle cell, and you can literally burn it for ATP during your workout. All right, so the other thing you need is glucose. You increase glucose in the blood, you probably break down your glycogen stores. Glucose is a carb. It's the circulation form of sugar in the body. You have all the types of sugar that's out there. Circulation form of sugar. Okay, so we increase that. Maybe you break down glycogen, put that as a side note. When you break down glycogen, glycogen is largely in your skeletal muscle and your liver. That's where your body stores glycogen. Skeletal muscle, liver. A lot of popular diets, I put diets in quotes, we all have a diet, right? We all eat something, that's your diet. But a lot of diets that are called low carb, why are they low carb? What are they trying to do? If you don't eat carb, well, your body still needs it. Where are you going to get it from? The glycogen you got in your body, okay? And a lot of times when you break down glycogen, water follows. So you lose a lot of water weight. So usually that phase of the diet is very effective, but it's just mostly water weight because you're trying to deplete your glycogen stores. Because if you deplete your glycogen stores, what's left to burn?
Fat.
Fat. I think that's the point of the diet. I don't really buy into them. Try working out if you got no glycogen. You can't do it. It'd be like the worst run of your life. Okay. If you're an athlete, you should be loading up on carbs. Okay. You'll perform better. Research does show that.
What about ketosis?
Oh yeah, ketoacidosis.
Yeah.
From the low carb diet.
Yeah.
Yeah, because if you increase your protein intake, it can lead to that. Right? Because you have to eat something, right? So I think a lot of the calories are coming from excess protein. So when you eat protein, protein is a dirty fuel. It doesn't burn clean. When you burn fat and carb, it's all hydrocarbon. So the byproduct is just CO2 and water. But proteins have that amine group that the body has to deal with, and it can cause problems if you eat too much of it. I want to move away from growth hormone. So if you're fit, you're working out, what do you think happens to the growth hormone in your body, up or down?
Up.
Okay. That's why a lot of athletes abuse it. You know, prior to the 80s, they didn't have the molecular biology to clone it and synthesize it, but now we do. Before that, all you could do was extract it from a cadaver. Okay, but since it's been cloned, I mean, you can see why an athlete would want to inject it, okay, beyond what their body can produce. Yeah, question?
I have a question. Would the pancreas be involved here at all in order to break down the glycogen? So would we have to use glucagon, or are we just using the growth hormone?
Let's see, so you're asking if glucagon and this can kind of work together. Yeah, probably. Yeah, I think exercise does increase both growth hormone and glucagon, but I don't know if it, the time course, if it happens at the same time or anything like that. Growth hormone. So exercise will increase the levels. What do you think happens to the growth hormone levels as you get older, decades of your life, up or down? Down. I'm getting old, I can feel it. I need more growth hormone. But as long as, you know, you stay fit, you know, I can kind of keep my levels up somewhat. Okay, so the next hormone I have is estrogen, and I have prolactin, that's the one I want to teach, but estrogen affects its levels. Prolactin, pro-lactin, referring to milk, pro means before, this is the hormone that will cause milk production in the mammary glands. It says mammary glands, and I'll say that. So, PRL. Let's talk about it, mostly what it does for females. Now, females, let's consider two scenarios. When the female is not pregnant, going through a normal menstrual cycle, and then when a female is pregnant, okay, two different scenarios. So let's take the first scenario where I have up there on the slide, this is the sign for female normal cycle. You know, the normal menstrual cycle. Whenever you hear that term, menstrual means month, because on average, it's about a month, about 28 days, right, on average. And I'll teach more of that when I get to repro. For now, just to know what kind of prolactin does. For this cycle, basically, for a couple of weeks, estrogen cycles increases, and it gets a little bit higher. And for another couple of weeks of that normal cycle, it's a little bit lower. So when it's a little bit higher, that's a stimulus for its release. So I'm writing up arrow, increase in estrogen stimulates PRL, prolactin release. Now, generally, that's not enough for full-on milk production in the mammary gland, but maybe there will be some breast swelling and tenderness during that time of the month. So during time when it cycles low, you have less of it, so maybe there's less sensitivity in the breast area. So the other scenario is when we're actually pregnant, the placenta kicks in about 1 or 2 months during pregnancy. You'll have much higher estrogen levels secreted by the placenta for the developing baby. And that'll cause much more release of prolactin for full-on milk production in the mammary gland. So Yeah, I would just put big, I'll put a double up arrow estrogen. Stimulates PRL release more so this time causing milk production. In mammary glands. Those are the milk producing structures in the breast. So in males, I don't even really teach anything. Basically, very low estrogens in males, and so there's no prolactin development of the breast in males. All right, let's see here. Yeah?
I have a quick question. So what's the cause of someone not having a lot of milk production?
Oh, the cause?
Yeah.
Like a nursing mother who's having trouble with that?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I've had a top answer. That's a tough one. If you want to become a lactation nurse and study that, I don't know. Any other questions? Milk production, milk letdown. So the basic idea of milk production, prolactin, which is the one for milk letdown. Oxytocin, there's two different things. We'll go back to that one. That was oxytocin for milk letdown. I always jokingly say that if you're having sex with your pregnant wife, you're whisking a squirt in the face, right? And milk let down. Milk comes out of it. If you think about it, you'll get it if you don't get it. Okay, well anyways, that's the physiology of those hormones. And I didn't do them all. I skipped ACTH and GnRH. And you know, I want to give some time, not now, but later today, to kind of have you think about it, maybe do it in class later today. Something else, these last three slides, I'm gonna have to think about this later. Look at this picture. Let's review pituitary stuff that I talked about. And look, I used a different picture, right? It doesn't matter what picture I use. If you understand the pituitary, you can apply it to any picture that I throw at you in a quiz or a test. Okay, so I say hypothalamic portal system. Identify the three parts of a portal system. And I point to them, A, B, and C. And sometimes students get confused on tests. What is he pointing to? Well, if I tell you it's the portal system, can you name the three parts? For example, some of you have been studying, and what would you say for A? Cap and water. Very good. What's B pointing to? Portal vein. Yeah, yeah. And some students on a test might say, oh, he's pointing to the infundibulum. Why is that incorrect? What's the question? The portal system. Okay, so you got to read the question here. What's C pointing to? Yeah, cap, bed, two, right? What about this one? Based on lecture, is that a vascular or neural connection? Well, it's a blood vessel. It's vascular. Now here's a picture of the posterior lobe. And I want you to identify different things here too. Let's see, A, B, C. For A, I am going for the connecting stalk, because on today's quiz, the infundibulum or pituitary stalk. B, they lasso these little axons. And there was a big fancy name for that. The hypothalamic hypophyseal tract. Very good. And C is just pointing to the posterior lobe. And it's there's the optic chiasm, right? Okay. And so there's the posterior one. And there's a capillary bed, right, that can take the hormones into the bloodstream. So I thought I'd throw those pictures at you just to show you different pictures of the same thing that we studied about in the Marriott book. Okay. All right, let me start the third set of slides. Looks like this. I'm dealt with pituitary. I'm going to move on to different glands today. Let's see how far I can get. We'll start with the adrenal gland. Basically, the adrenal gland secretes catecholamines. It's also called the suprarenal gland. Renal refers to kidney. We do a dissection of the kidney, dissect it and remove it from the body. You got this, kidney-shaped organ. It's the kidney. And on top of it is what we're talking about. That's the adrenal gland, right there. Think of this gland as basically a stress response gland. Remember, I give you a page number and it says Gilroy, and or if you see this gray footer. It's a picture from the Atlas of Anatomy that's in the syllabus. Not all pictures are, but for the books I made to buy, I'll give you those page numbers as we move along. This picture, you're just cutting the gland open, and you're seeing that there's a cortex and medulla that was on today's quiz. I'm gonna go into more detail on that. There's also a capsule, okay? So there's a capsule surrounding it, has a capsule function, which keeps things in place, has no physiology function really, just a capsule. Not to be confused with the cortex. I don't really ask you about capsule, but I want you to know it because I don't want you to confuse it with cortex, and then you also have medulla. Capsule. Don't confuse it or part of the cortex. Your adrenal cortex is basically for long-term stress responses. It will secrete corticosteroids that help you deal with stress over the long term. Adrenal cortex secretes corticosteroids. Stress responses. Long term is basically weeks, days, weeks, maybe months, something like that on that time scale. Usually we live incredibly safe lives. Now I'm talking about if you're like, well, you know, stranded in the forest or, you know, stranded at sea, you know, no food, running out of water, running out of rations, extreme stress over a long period of time. But I'll talk about the corticosteroids and what they help do during that time. So the adrenal medulla is for short-term stress responses. That's your catecholamines, epi and norepi. Secrete epi, norepi, your catecholamines, talked about those the last time. Those help you deal with short-term stress responses. You know, minutes, maybe an hour or two, seconds, minutes, hours. To deal with short-term stress response. like, for example, if I'm jogging and this has happened to me, or I see a big dog running down the street right at me, why run the other way? Short-term stress response, right? I'm already running, I might as well just run away, I'm not gonna try to fight the dog. But that kind of a thing, where you're under remarkable stress for a short period of time. Catecholamines, they really increase metabolic strength. You always hear about the stories of maybe a grandma who has the strength to lift the car off of her granddaughter who's trapped under a car. You know, that kind of strength. Increase metabolic strength. Like I said in my jogging analogy, I chose the flight, and it's an instinct. Some people react with fight, okay? The reaction might be just to punch someone in the face as an instinct reaction. Most people react with flight. Okay, kind of cower away or run away. Fight or flight refers to the adrenal medulla. Now, we have histology slides, and whenever I include pictures like this, and the quality's not that good, you know it's from our collection, right? It's just not as good as the one you find on the internet. But let's work with it, because I expect you to know our slides. Now, I've labeled it for you to kind of help ease you into it. Capsule, cortex, medulla. Okay, and I can ask you that on a quiz or a test. Could you identify cortex or medulla? Try to train your eye to see the subtle differences in the tissue. Here's a better picture from the internet. Let me turn the lights back on. All right, so number one is pointing to this inner region here. If you had to guess.
That's the medulla.
Yeah, that would be the medulla. But then what I didn't mention yet is the cortex actually has three different zones. So before we identify the other ones, let's go to this slide. So do you know what you're looking at this slide? Pay very close attention to this little box right there. You see how they're boxing it? And they're trying to show you all the cortex and just a little piece of the medulla on the bottom. And I like to do the same thing for quizzes. I'll get a slide focus, I'll get the right magnification, and I'll just try to show you a part of the slide that shows you cortex and medulla so you can see it all. And I do expect you to be able to identify the different zones of the adrenal cortex. Let me go through that. So you might want to know the adrenal cortex has three zones. So I'll go through those now. The top zone underneath the capsule, I'll point to the illustration. The cells are arranged into these little oval clumps. The zone is called zona glomerulosa. Write that down. Cells arranged in oval clumps. Now, the word glomer, this word root, means a ball of yarn. Because the cells are like little balls of yarn, I guess. So the name of the zone is named for the appearance of the cells, basically. Now, why you need to know this is, this zone, these cells, secrete a class of corticosteroids called mineralocorticoids. So there's different types of corticosteroids. One type regulates, you know, minerals, electrolytes in your body. Then there's one you got to know of this class of hormones that I already taught yesterday, aldosterone. That's the one you got to know. We had talked about yesterday, it's responsible for sodium reabsorption in the kidney. Put that as a note. So that is secreted from the zona glomerulosa. You know, the widest zone, this zone here, the zona fasciculata, it's the middle zone. The cells are arranged more or less into vertical cords. Basically, what you got to know is they secrete glucocorticoids, this zone. This class of corticosteroids, the glucocorticoids, you can guess what they regulate, sugar. There's one you got to know, it's cortisol. So no cortisol. It can increase, cortisol increases blood glucose. So let's think about this. This is the straight up textbook physiology. Think about how this benefits you in a long-term stress response. You're trying to survive. Sodium reabsorption. I said water follows, and what does that do to BP? Up or down? It helps maintain, increase BP. That's useful if you're trying to survive. Increase blood glucose. That's useful. The brain can only metabolize sugar, okay? Because nothing else can get past the blood-brain barrier. So that's useful for a survival situation. The third zone is not so important for the long-term stress response, but I'll teach it anyways. The zona reticularis, this bottom zone right next to the medulla. Now, you see that word reticular a lot in anatomy and physiology. It just means complex network, because the cells, they're not arranged in any orderly fashion, just complex network of cells. This zone is usually not that big. The illustration has it like this thick, and usually I see it really reduced in our slides, but if I point to a zone that's right next to the medulla, you know what I'm going for. Just remember the ordering. Top to bottom on this picture, zona glomerulosa, fasciculata, reticularis, then medulla. Okay. Again, be able to identify the capsule. Otherwise, you're going to call capsule zona glomerulosa. So remember the cellular arrangement. Sometimes the glomerulosa looks like round little balls of yarn. The capsule is a fibrous connective tissue, flat cells. The zona reticularis secrete the sex hormones. Now, the importance of the sex hormones from the adrenal cortex, to my knowledge, they don't do anything. Maybe they help kickstart puberty, but the main hormones in adults come from the gonads, the ovaries and the testes. So I really don't talk about this too much, sex hormones from the zona reticularis. I'll just know that and just be able to identify the zone. So now that I taught the zones, if I go back to the previous slide, Can you find zona reticularis?
Yeah.
I would say two. Can you see two as being it? What about glomerulosa? Two is reticularis. If you look over here, see the four over there? That's the outermost zone. And then fasciculata, three. And it's the widest zone. And it usually does stain the lightest as it does in this image. Okay. Here's another picture from our collection. I'll skip forward a couple of slides here. I got it labeled, capsule, glomerulosa, fasciculata, reticularis, and adrenal medulla. And I took the picture for you. And the challenge is in your histology lab, if you can get the slide and get a picture that looks like this and identify the different zones. And I have a little memory jogger, salt, sugar, sex, right? Because salt refers to which zone? Glomerulosa, because aldosterone regulates sodium. Sugar, fasciculata, because cortisol regulates blood glucose. And sex for zona reticularis, because it secretes the sex hormone. So salt, sugar, sex, quick memory jogger to help you remember the functions there. And this slide, I just kind of have all the notes we already took here. The salt, the sugar, the sex, and I already mentioned the catecholamines, epi and norepi. It's secreted from the adrenal medulla about 80-20. I don't expect you to memorize the molecular structure, but you should at least recognize that four hydrocarbon ring structure of all corticosteroids. I even think I use this image for today's quiz. On this slide, I don't expect you to commit it to memory. What I do want you to know is that all corticosteroids, all three classes, are closely related and they're derived from cholesterol. I would know that. All corticosteroids are derived from cholesterol. And what I did to the figure, I just put arrows next to the ones I talked about today. I got an arrow next to cortisol and aldosterone. And one thing I would know that's going to come up again on this test, the hormonal difference for the sex hormones, for males and for females, is due to one enzyme called aromatase. So I would note that androstenedione and testosterone, which are the male sex hormones, they're converted to the female sex hormones, estrone, estradiol, those are your two chief estrogens, they're converted by aromatase. So I would note that. Androstenedione. Estrogen by aromatase. So you got the androgens and the estrogens. So hormonally, the difference between males and females is one enzyme, aromatase. Researchers who study sex determination and differentiation, they study that enzyme. So that's important. That'll come up again. All right, so those are the corticosteroids. Now that zona glomerulosa, I want to talk about it in more detail here, because aldosterone regulates blood pressure, and anything that regulates blood pressure, I like to emphasize a little more in this class, because it regulates sodium, which helps maintain or increase BP. Let's talk about the ways you can stimulate aldosterone's release from that zona glomerulosa, or you can inhibit it, okay? If you're stimulating aldosterone's release, the body must want to increase BP. But if BP is too high or stays elevated for too long, maybe you want to decrease aldosterone's release to lower blood pressure. So you want to inhibit aldosterone's release. High BP, in the presence of that, atrial natriuretic peptide can inhibit its release. Let me write that down. I haven't mentioned that yet. Inhibited, the hormone name is atrial natriuretic peptide. That's what I'm writing. Atrial natriuretic peptide inhibits aldosterone's release. Knowing that fact, think about the physiology. Less aldosterone means BP is going to drop. So let's go back to the three ways you can stimulate it. I'll use this picture to kind of illustrate that. Mentioned AMP, that inhibits it. These three things will stimulate it. But to talk about atrial natriuretic peptide, where does that come from? I didn't teach the heart yet. Two of the chambers of the heart are the atria. This peptide comes from the heart. It can help inhibit that zone to decrease, has an inhibitory effect to decrease blood pressure. Okay, so the stimulatory things. These three things all stimulate its release. I'll mention two and three right now because I've already mentioned them. Low sodium. Or ACTH stimulate the release of aldosterone. Stimulate aldosterone's release. And if you think about that, if you increase aldosterone, you're going to increase blood pressure. You're going to reabsorb sodium and take water with it. So, we talked about this last time. This mechanism of triggering the release of a hormone, if you have a low blood level, that's a humoral effect to stimulate a release of a hormone. And what's this one? That's a hormonal cause to stimulate the release of a hormone. So the question I always ask, maybe you got it right on today's quiz, is ACTH, is that tropic? Yes or no? The answer is yes. It controls the release of another hormone. Which one? Aldosterone. Okay, so ACTH can do it, so can low blood levels. So those are two of the ways I mentioned already. The third way is a cascade. Look at this picture right there. It says, if you have low blood pressure, the kidney can help. It'll help increase blood pressure by releasing renin. Then it says, initiates cascade that produces angiotensin II. Now, I do want you to know that full cascade. This is an incomplete story here. So let me kind of map it out for you. The word cascade, maybe it should invoke a little bit of fear in physiology students, because if it's one you got to know, you have to memorize a lot of steps. So let me go through it. So yes, I'm saying you have to memorize what I'm about to teach. This is an important one, regulates blood pressure. So what is the body trying to do? It's reacting to the stimulus, which is low blood volume and or blood pressure. Maybe you're dehydrated, there's decreased blood volume, decreased BP, you're trying to correct that. The kidney has a way to pick up on that disturbance. What the kidney will do is secrete renin into the bloodstream. So I'll pretend I have a big blood vessel here. Renin secreted into the bloodstream. Now, what's not on that picture, the liver secretes a molecule called angiotensinogen. So that makes it into the bloodstream. Both of these are secreted into the bloodstream, and what renin will do, this is kind of like always there, but inactive, doesn't do anything, make it active to help deal with the low blood pressure. Renin will cleave a part off of this angiotensinogen, converting it into angiotensin 1. So I'll put the word cleave. So then you get a conversion of that molecule, angiotensinogen becomes angiotensin 1. Angiotensin 1 is also inactive. What happens is this molecule will travel to the blood capillaries in the lung, called pulmonary capillaries. In the pulmonary capillaries, there's an active enzyme called ACE. ACE is an acronym for angiotensin converting enzyme. I'll write that down here. ACE equals angiotensin. Converting enzyme. Okay, and what it does is it'll convert angiotensin 1 into angiotensin 2. Okay, so I'll just put ANG1 for short, and ACE will convert it into ANG2, angiotensin 2 for short. ANG is angiotensin. So I'm describing, take a time out, I'm describing this first one. I call this the RAS mechanism. I'm going to write that as a title for this flow chart. RAS mechanism. That mechanism, the R stands for renin. The first A is angiotensin, all the angiotensin 1 and 2. The second A is aldosterone. Okay, so let's talk about angiotensin 2, what it can do. So far in the cascade, angiotensinogen inactive, doesn't really do anything to my knowledge. Angiotensin 1 inactive, doesn't really do anything. This one does. It can do two things to help raise blood pressure. One, it can vasoconstrict arterioles. I'm drawing a capillary bed with an artery and vein attached to it like I did yesterday. because I know we haven't had cardio yet. So when I say vasoconstrict, constrict means to like tighten, put a chokehold on it. The arterioles are the smallest arteries before you get to the capillaries. Okay. So what I want you to understand is how this vasoconstriction can increase BP. If you vasoconstrict right there, kind of just kind of like squeeze it and increase the resistance to blood flow, is it easier or harder for blood to flow past that chokehold? It's harder. So what we say in physiology words, you're increasing the peripheral resistance. You're increasing the resistance for blood to flow. So if you're doing that, you're keeping more blood in the arteries. If you're keeping more blood in the arteries, what's happening to the pressure in those arteries? Pressure's going up. It's kind of like you're diverting the blood to where you want the blood to go more in some kind of stress response. Okay, but anyways, vasoconstriction increases blood pressure. That's basically what I want you to know. All right, the other thing you can do is it targets, well, as the picture shows, the zona glomerulosa to secrete aldosterone. I'm going to have to erase some things here. I'm running out of room. But this is just this part here. And two will activate, cause the release of aldosterone. Aldosterone has a target. What's the target? Kidney. What's its effect on the kidney? We did talk about that yesterday. It facilitates the reabsorption of sodium. What follows sodium?
Water.
Yeah, through the osmosis. And basically you're going to increase blood volume and increase blood pressure. So that's the ultimate end game there. So basically I told you two things that angiotensin II can do to increase the blood pressure. One, vasoconstrict. The one next to this. Two, you're going to increase the aldosterone levels. And know the physiology that happens after that. Okay, now I know I kind of went all over the place on the board. I don't have a big enough board. I don't have enough boards. But so, you know, I included a slide that has all the steps I went through. You can go through that if your notes are a mess. And you can see, just as a quick recap, recap is the exact same thing we just did. Numbered neatly. Dehydration, low BP, something like that, right here. That's the stress. You have decreased volume, decreased pressure. The kidney secretes renin. The liver secretes angiotensinogen. So you increase levels of angiotensin 1. In the lungs, ACE will convert it to angiotensin 2. And that's the thing that can do two things to up your blood pressure. One, vasoconstriction. Two, it's right here. Adrenal cortex, aldosterone, kidneys increase water reabsorption, increase blood volume, both of these increase the blood pressure. So it's all right there for you if you're having trouble following the notes you took. Any questions on that cascade? I'm gonna go back to one slide, this one. Renin and ACE are cleavers. I had mentioned that for renin. It cleaves angiotensinogen right there. You don't have to know that. That's the conversion process. You're just cleaving a part off to make it active. ACE is also a cleaver. It cleaves angiotensin 1, and then you call it by default angiotensin 2. I didn't write that here. ACE cleaves. So anytime you know a cascade and you can invent a drug that interferes with the cascade and you can alter the physiology, you can help patients. So you don't have to memorize this cascade, but I wanted to show you a slide on ACE inhibitors. So we just talked about the RAS mechanism. It's central to control blood pressure. And basically, now I'm going to talk about ACE inhibitors. RAS can be the target of antihypertensive drugs, ACE inhibitors. Angiotensin II induces aldosterone synthesis in the adrenal cortex. And so aldosterone increases salt and water reabsorption at the kidney, increasing blood pressure. So I have some questions for you here. Question, how would ACE inhibiting drugs affect the levels of angiotensin II? Would that go up or down? ACE inhibiting drugs. So I have to think about it. So I just teach. Okay, you're inhibiting ACE. You should decrease Ang II if you have an ACE inhibitor. Because what does ACE do? It increases Ang II. So if you inhibit ACE, you decrease angiotensin II. So if you're inhibiting the rest of the cascade, you're going to decrease aldosterone levels and decrease blood pressure. All right, I think it's time for a break. 9:30, it's about that time. I'll finish this up and come back to break.